So the entire process of a non-resident Indian selling his property in India will attract two processes. That is, first is tax implication and second is repatriation implication. Now let us start with tax implications. Whenever a seller sells a property to a buyer, in this case the seller is a non-resident Indian and the buyer can be either a non-resident Indian or a resident Indian. Now, in India, the concept of deducting TDS also applies to sale of property in India. So, the buyer will deduct the TDS and thereby remit whatever is left to the seller. So, in this case, let's say Mr. A, a non-resident Indian, sells his property in India to Mr. B. Mr. B will deduct TDS, let's say the sale consideration is 1 crore. Mr. B will deduct the TDS, let's say 2%. So he will deduct 2 lakhs and remit 98 lakhs to Mr. A. So this is basically the concept of TDS in India that also applies to immovable property. Now, in case Mr. B does not deduct the TDS or he fails to do so, the onus of paying the tax is still on Mr. A because he has received the whole 1 CR. And TDS was not deducted. So now Mr. A is still liable to pay the tax to the government on the sale of the immovable property. So coming on to how to decide what rate of TDS is to be deducted by the buyer. So my first suggestion will be, please go to a professional in case you are part of such a transaction, because it can be a little complicated. Now, in India, whenever a property is held for less than 2 years, less than or equal to 2 years, that property is a short-term capital asset. And when a property is held for more than 2 years, it is a long-term capital asset. Tax rate on short-term capital asset is 20% and tax rate on long-term capital asset is 30%. Now, if your income is more than 5 lakh rupees in India, then you are liable to pay tax. So, if after sale of immovable property, the amount which you get is more than 5 lakh, then you will obviously calculate the tax amount on the same, on the income. After you calculate the tax amount plus the surcharge amount, there is cess, that is education cess of 4%, which will be applicable on the final amount. After calculating all this, whatever is the amount, that TDS the buyer needs to deduct and the balance amount he has to pay to the seller, that is the NRI. Now, I'm sure this must have sound very complicated. So that is what I said, you can take help of a professional to help you calculate the actual amount of tax, because if the buyer ends up deducting less TDS, then you can get a notice from the income tax authority that you have not paid the whole tax. So the next question one can ask is whether a non-resident Indian can be granted the benefit of indexation. Yes. Now, what is indexation? For a property held for more than 2 years, that property is a long-term capital asset. Indexation benefit can only be given to long-term capital assets. So what an indexation does, it counts in the factor of inflation over the period of years for which you have held the property. So let's say the sale consideration is 100 and the cost of the property is 40. So in this case, the long-term capital gain will be 60 and you will have to pay tax on 60. But with the help of indexation, cost of 40 into the index factor of the year of sale upon index factor of the year of purchase, let's say now the cost of 40 has increased to 60. So 100 minus 60, now the long-term capital gain will only be 40 as against 60, and the tax on which and the tax which you will pay on 40 will be lesser than before. For all those property which were held before the year 2000, fair market value of the year 2000 is to be taken. So guys, we have discussed the first part of sale of property by a non-resident Indian, that is the tax implications. We have discussed the concept of TDS, we have discussed the calculation of tax, we have discussed whether you can go to an IT officer, and we have discussed the concept of indexation. Now, let us get to the second part, that is the repatriation implication, which is really, really important from the practical aspect. After you, for example, there are many non-resident Indians who no longer have roots in India. They don't have any family in India. So if they have a inherited property or a family property, they intend to sell it, take the money and settle back in the, you know, in the country, in the foreign country. Now for such people, the idea of repatriation is very, very important, because they want that the money which they get from sale of the property, they want that money to be able to, you know, take it with them in the foreign country. So the next question is whether a non-resident Indian repatriate this money from the sale of property in India. Well, this completely depends upon how the property was purchased. So the property could have been purchased in three ways. First is, the property was purchased out of funds from NRO NRE accounts. Second is, the property was inherited in India. The third is, the property was purchased from a local savings bank account, the funds from a local savings bank account. So if you observe, the first point where the property was purchased from NRO NRE account, the source is inward remittance. The second and third point, that it was either inherited or it was purchased from a local savings bank account, then this is basically the property was purchased from the Indian income source. Now, in the first case, because the property was purchased from inward remittance, the limit of repatriation is $1 million per annum per person without RBI approval. If the amount exceeds, then RBI approval is compulsory. In the second and third case, because the property was purchased from Indian source, the limit is in the second and third case, because the property was purchased from Indian source, the limit is $250,000 under the liberated remittance scheme, that is the LRS scheme. So, well, it is evident that proper records need to be maintained while purchasing the property. So normally what happens, you may have purchased a property and obviously no one thinks about selling the property while they purchase the property. So proper documents may not have been maintained, but please note, this will directly influence how your repatriation later on, in case you do decide to sell the property. Also, the second thing to be done is filing form 15CACB. This is very, very important. Firstly, not doing so may attract penalties. Second is, it may affect the amount you can or cannot repatriate. So form 15CA is to be filed by the person repatriating the amount from India, and all the details will be mentioned. Where did the money come from? What was the transaction? Who the transaction was in between? Everything. Form 15CB is basically a certificate issued by a chartered accountant, and therein the tax calculation, the TDS amount, the ITR is filed or not, all these verifications will be done. Now, why is Form 15CACB so important? Now let's say you have sold a property and the purchase was done under inward remittance, and you are now eligible to remit $1 million per annum. Now in the same year, you may have received a gift from a relative. Now that gift is from basically an Indian source. So in case of that gift, you may want to repatriate that gift also. It may be a cash gift. Now, in case of that gift, it will come under a LRS scheme, that is $250,000. If you do not file Form 15CACB for the first property transaction, the income tax will not understand that you have two transactions taking place. One is under without the RBI approval of rupees $1 million, and the second is a normal LRS transaction. If you do, you will be able to repatriate both. That is, your limit will now be 10 lakhs plus 2 point, that is 12,50,000 dollars. So one very commonly asked question is, can a non-resident own an agricultural land or can a non-resident sell an agricultural land? The answer is a non-resident Indian cannot buy an agricultural land from inward remittance. That is, he or she cannot buy an agricultural land from NRO NRE accounts. But he can inherit a land. He can also buy the local the agricultural land from local savings account. Can a non-resident Indian sell an agricultural land? Yes, a non-resident Indian can sell an agricultural land and also repatriate as per the LRS scheme. That is $2,50,000 per annum per person. So coming to the end of this, let's discuss something very interesting, that is tax planning in case of a non-resident Indian selling a property in India. So let's say the LRS scheme is applicable to me. That is, I had purchased the property from an Indian income source. Now what I can do is, let's say this, the sale consideration is $1 million. And I am only eligible to repatriate $2,50,000 out of it. But I want to repatriate the whole amount. Will I be able to do so? Well, there is one solution to this. And the solution needs to be legally viable. That is, under FEMA and income tax laws, both the laws, there should be no issue. Like basically, you need to be compliant with both the laws. So what you can do is, you can gift this property to, let's say, 4 immediate relatives. And after gifting, you can sell the property. Now, once you sell, each and every 4 of them will receive $2,50,000. And now all 4 of them can be eligible under the LRS scheme. And your entire $10 lakh can now be repatriated. Also, one thing to note, when I gift a property to my immediate relative, there is no income tax liability. And the only expense to be made is the stamp duty, which varies from state to state. And last, very important, I think, is saving your long-term capital gains. So under the Income Tax Act, you can get exemption from paying the long-term capital gain to a certain limit under 3 sections, Section 54, Section 54F and Section 54EC. So these 3 sections I'm planning to talk about in detail in another session. And well, I hope you really liked this video, and I have covered tax implication as well as repatriation implication. And in case there is any suggestion or well, how did you like my content, please comment. If you have liked my video, please like, subscribe and ring the bell icon. Thank you.